Good morning, good morning, good morning. We're so glad to have all of you here and have all of you on this 13th Sunday after Pentecost, which doesn't really mean much to some, the 13th Sunday after Pentecost. We're so glad to have you here online and in person. And so on this Sunday, I woke up this morning. I haven't been outside lately, but when I went outside, it looked like the humidity might be breaking a little bit. So I'm a little bit excited, and so I give praise to God for that because of just the sports that I've been part of watching and just being outside. That also lets me tell you that I'm grateful for it because today, from 3 to 4, our 6th through 8th grader, and from 4 to 5, our 9th to 12th graders, we'll meet at Hayes Arboretum today for our first in-person gathering. Just a time really just to connect again through social distancing and keeping our what everyone knows, what is kind of the norm now. And then we'll take a little hike and have a little bit of fun together. Let me say that again. So if you're online watching or if you're here today, 6th through 8th, we'll meet from 3 to 4. And our 9th through 12th today, we'll meet from 4 to 5. Meet directly at Hayes Arboretum right over there, right in the parking lot. We'll meet. Hopefully you can make it. It's an hour. If you're in the youth, just stop by and you can drop your kids off and come back and get them an hour, go to Starbucks, get a coffee and come back and get them. We'd love to have you. So if you're online or in person, we really want it to be. And from Josh, Kara, and I to all of you, we will do everything we possibly know to keep your kids safe. So please make that important in their lives today. We've been also asked to share that there was a table out there with free shirts on it. We've been trying to get rid of these for a while. Then we went into isolation, so then they were sitting outside for a while. So we'd ask you to please take one, two, all of them. That's fine. Take them home to your grandchildren or yourself, or even if you know a little neighborhood kid that would look great in a neon shirt, grab one of them, throw it as him rides his bike by your house. However you need to, please, we're trying to get rid of them today. So if you don't get rid of all of them, I'm dropping them off at Mr. Carter's house, who preached a couple weeks ago right on his front door. He asked for all the extras. So please, please, please. So in short, free shirts in the black back, please take one if you can use it. I want to share last Sunday at 1 o'clock at the other end of the building, we had our confirmation service. We couldn't do it in person, and the kids couldn't give their faith talks in person because of what's going on. But through our own technology, it is on the website. So if you scroll to the bottom of our website at FELC Online, you can skip through all the parts of Pastor John and I talking and get to that first kid that sits up at the podium down there, or the lectern, and begins to tell his story of his faith. I share that because I think every year when I hear it, it rekindles my own faith. My own faith, and excites me about what we're doing here and my own call as a pastor. So I encourage you this week, if you have 10 minutes, it'll take you, scroll through and just listen to a couple of them. First, you'll be amazed at how grown up our kids have been. Some of you have seen them grow up from little kids all the way to now. And now they share why they believe what they believe. So it's a great way that you can be rekindled, hear the stories again. And so that's on our website. Scroll to the bottom. When you get there, it'll be the second square because this will be the first square. And if you're online, stay online now to the worship. Don't go looking for it right now. So that's part of it. Today's a big day for our church. Today's a big day because we are offering communion service in person. We're going to take communion here in our fellowship hall. But we'll also be asking those at home, if you'd like to join us, we also would love to have you. And just a little bit of note for those joining, if you are planning to join Holy Communion from home today, we will invite you to have the elements, the bread and the wine, prepared before we get to that part in the service. If you're new to a guest or not familiar with in our service, that is, Holy Communion's right after the sermon. So once Pastor John's done talking or preaching, you can get your things ready. And you will raise your bread and wine as I do that at the altar. I'll explain more when we get to that part of the service. And when you all that are in person today, we'll also explain sort of how that's going to work. We've asked Rick and Nancy Funk to sort of help guide people as they come forward. Pastor John and I will be here and he will be there. And we just ask you to use all the ways of social distancing and things like that you use out in the public. We're glad that we're able to offer that today. We're glad as pastors to be able to preside at communion. We're glad to be here together to worship God. Brothers and sisters, it's a great day. It's a great day because God continues to love us. God calls us together as a group of congregation, as a congregation together to worship online and in person. So I invite you to please stand, because we know we are broken. We need to confess that, but we also need to hear the words of forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, the one who fashions us, the one who heals us, the one who reforms us again and again. Amen. Let us take a moment for our own. No, let us confess our sin, calling for God's transforming power, and let us take a personal moment just to reflect on our past week and life we live. Source of all life, we confess that we have not allowed you or grace to set us free. We fear that we are not good enough. We hear your word of love and freely given to us, and yet we expect others to earn it. You turn the church inward rather than moving it outward. Forgive us, stir us, reform us to be a church powered by love, willing to speak what is right, act for what is just, and seek the healing of our whole creation. Amen. Real words that we must speak, real words that we need to speak out loud to remind us of who we are. But here's the good news. These are also real and true words that I proclaim to you now. God hears our cry and sends the Spirit to change us and to empower our lives in the world. Our sins, your sins, are forgiven. God's love is unconditional, and we are raised up as God's people who will always be made new in Jesus Christ. Amen. We sing our first song, The Table.
The table of the Lord.
is our God who calls us to come as we are. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Our litany of praise comes from Psalm 26. Give judgment for me, O Lord, for I have lived with integrity. I have trusted in the Lord and have not faltered. For your steadfast love is before my eyes. I have walked faithfully with you. I have hated the company of evildoers. I will not sit down with the wicked. Singing aloud a song of thanksgiving and recounting all your wonderful deeds. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, we give you thanks for your Son, who chose the path of suffering for the sake of the world. Humble us by his example, point us to the path of obedience, and give us strength to follow your commands. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
Our first reading is from Jeremiah 15, verses 15 to 21. O Lord, you know, remember me and visit me, and bring down retribution for me on my persecutors. In your forbearance, do not take me away. Know that on your account I suffer insult. Your words were found, and I ate them, and your words became to me a joy and the delight of my heart, for I am called by your name, O Lord, God of hosts. I did not sit in the company of merrymakers, nor did I rejoice. Under the weight of your hand, I sat alone, for you had filled me with indignation. Why is my pain unceasing, my wound incurable, refusing to be healed? Truly, you are to me like a deceitful brook, like waters that fail. Therefore, thus says the Lord, if you turn back, I will take you back, and you shall stand before me. If you utter what is precious and not what is worthless, you shall serve as my mouth. It is they who will turn to you, not you who will turn to them. And I will make you to this people a fortified wall of bronze. They will fight against you, but they shall not prevail over you. For I am with you to save you and deliver you, says the Lord. I will deliver you out of the hand of the wicked and redeem you from the grasp of the ruthless. The word of the Lord. The second reading is from Romans 12, 9 to 21. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit, serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope, be patient in suffering, persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints, extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you, bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice, weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another, do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God, for it is written, "Vengeance is mine, I will repay," says the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. The word of the Lord. I think you're supposed to stand.
Gospels in Matthew's 16th chapter, beginning with verse 21. From that time on, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "God forbid it, Lord. This must never happen to you." But Jesus turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." Then Jesus told his disciples, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit them if they gain the whole world but forfeit their life? Or what will they give in return for their life? For the Son of Man is to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay everyone for what has been done. Truly I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Grace and mercy and peace be unto you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus, who is the Christ. Amen. Proclamation and explanation. Today we go from proclamation, who Jesus is, to explanation. What does that mean? If this Sunday morning, and we are streaming, and we're glad to have any of you online to be a part of this, but if this was just a real TV show, it might begin with these words, "previously on an earlier episode," meaning last week's episode, meaning last week's sermon. Matthew 16, the verses were 13 to 20. Jesus was asking his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And even if you weren't here last week, you can guess what some of those answers were. Oh, maybe John the Baptist, or maybe Elijah, or Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. And then Jesus says to his disciples, "But who do you say that I am?" And Peter confesses. And I use that word on purpose. Confesses. Not like confesses is, "Lord, I'm sorry." Not like confession as in repentance, but confession as a confession of faith. And Peter literally says, "This is what I believe." He confesses, "You are the Christ. You are the Messiah," which is like saying, "You are the anointed one of God, the one that we all have been waiting for." In other words, last week, proclamation, this is who Jesus is, the Son of the living God. And then today's text literally starts right at the end of that story, verses 21 to 28. Yes, this is who you are, and today, this is what it means. Proclamation to explanation. What does it mean to be the Son of God? What does it mean to be God's beloved, anointed Son? And then for us, and that's why you're here, because you believe, your hearts are owned by the living Son of God. For us then, what does that mean to be a follower of Jesus? Proclamation to explanation. And I wrote down, how's that for a slam bam beginning? If you've never seen us online before, boy, it can't be more creative than that, can it? Yes, it can. I'm kind of poking fun at myself, but I'm here to tell you that proclamation to explanation is really the heart and soul of how to understand today's words. The disciples are traveling with Jesus outside the usual places, outside the area where he's best known, outside the area where the faith is best known. Last week's story started with her in the region of Caesarea Philippi. My Bible footnote, just my Bible footnote says it this way: this region is especially pagan. So they wouldn't know. Who are people saying that I am? Well, they've heard of the Baptist and they've heard of Elijah. But then who do you say that I am? Because they don't get it. But Peter gets it, or at least it looks like he gets it, and speaks, I think, for the disciples, you are the Christ. It's an absolute word of proclamation, and today sets out the explanation of what that means. What does it really mean to be the Son of God? And what does it really mean to be a follower of Jesus, who is the Christ? This word doesn't come from Peter. This word doesn't come from the disciples. This word comes from Jesus himself. And this word makes it clear what it is to be the Christ and what it is to be a follower of the Christ. The actual gospel today started from that moment on, from that time on, meaning from that moment that Peter confessed Jesus. Jesus then began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem, undergo great sufferings at the hands of the elders and chief priests and the scribes, and be killed and be raised on the third day. Great sufferings and be killed. From that moment on of Peter's proclamation, Jesus tells him, he's going to end up telling him three different times. But after this first time, here comes Peter. Now, if you're in worship today, and as I look around and see the ones here, and some of you mostly listening online, but others may not know that, but most of you know what's going to happen. We know what happens to Peter. But here comes Peter, who just spoke that beautiful word, truthful word of confession and faith. I love the picture. Peter, who has just confessed Jesus to be the Christ, can't you just say, Lord, I know you're the Christ. Yep, but come on over here. Come on over here. You can't be doing that. You can't be doing that. I think you have this whole thing wrong. The verb is a very strong verb. Peter rebukes Jesus. God forbid it, Lord. That can't happen. Rebuking the very Son of God. Now think about that for a minute. If you get to the gates of heaven, I don't know how it works, but don't begin by rebuking God. Peter rebukes the very Son of God, and you know what comes next. Get behind me, Satan. Satan takes us right back to the temptation. Jesus resists those temptations right after he's baptized in the wilderness. All three gospels tell us about it. You know, if you are the Christ, you surely should be saved. Turn rocks into bread, jump off the temple, God will protect you. And Jesus resists those temptations. And the version says this, so Satan departs until an opportune time. Here's the opportune time. Get behind me, Satan. Peter speaking as if it's Satan, okay? You're a stumbling block. You're a hindrance. You're an enticement. You're a temptation. Actually, the Greek word is you're a scandal. Scandalon. It's scandalous what you are saying, Peter. That's the way of the world, but not the way of the cross, not the way of the Lord, not the way of the Son of God. That's not God's way. You're setting your mind on earthly things, not on divine things. And when that word comes from the very Son of God, get behind me, Satan, you can almost picture Peter, like any of us have ever been scolded, just walking away with his tail between his legs. The other disciples saying, boy, I'm glad I didn't say that. He put him in his place. But that's not really what Jesus did. He's not putting Peter in his place. Jesus is making clear what the place of the kingdom of God is, what the place of the Son of God is, what the place is of those who are believers in Jesus. Now, the words absolutely had to flabbergast Peter and the disciples that Jesus shared. Jerusalem, suffering, killed. Absolutely had to flabbergast them, caught them by surprise. But tell the truth, as I look around at the folks gathered here and many of you listening online, those words really aren't a surprise to us. If I went up to any of you and not just the precious people that shared their faith last week, what a powerful word that was. But if I went up to any of you and said, well, what are some words that Jesus would say about our life? Deny yourself. Take up a cross. If you want to save your life, then lose your life. Give it away. Live for the kingdom. Tell the truth. We know those words by heart. We really do. Now, some watching online may not. Those may be new. The place of the kingdom of God is not a place of greatness and power and popularity. It's a place of serving and cross. We know it. We believe it. But we still struggle to live it out. I mean, it's true. Peter literally walked with Jesus, saw how it was done, but he still couldn't quite cope with this. This can't be the right way. But today Jesus says, this is the way of the Christ. It is the way. And he calls us to servanthood. Now, I don't need a bunch of churchy words to lay on you. I don't. I don't pretend to understand your Tuesdays and Thursdays and Saturday nights, any of that. The specifics of your life, they're all similar but not the same. So I'm not going to stand here and tell you exactly how you're to live that out. That letter that was from Romans, mercy, it spelled out really wonderful phrases. I always go back to that Old Testament prophet. What's God want from us? To love kindness, to do justice, and to walk humbly with the Lord. To love kindness, to do justice, and to walk humbly with the Lord. And then I wrote this down as I was working on this word. We do that with faith. We do that with belief. We do it to the best of our ability. And we do it with the power of the Holy Spirit helping us. And when we stumble, we fall down and confess and ask God to pick us up and put us back on the road. We do it with courage and willingness. And for whatever reason, out of my pen came this word, fortitude. Now think about the last time you used the word fortitude out loud. Fortitude, it's persistence, it's endurance, extraordinaire. Honestly, it's a lot like living through the days we're living through. COVID days, beginning to move around, but still limited. Can't just zoom out, can't just do exactly what we want, can't jump on an airplane and fly to Seattle, okay? We just can't do that. Fortitude. What fortitude means with COVID days is this. If you're having a day that somehow you're really coping with it well and you see all the extra blessings in life which are there, then you need to call and help someone else deal with that. And when you're having a day which for whatever reason down you are, then someone else with fortitude needs to call and get you through that day. That same fortitude is how we live out serving the kingdom of God day by day. Putting Christ first, ahead of ourselves. Putting others first, believe it or not, ahead of ourselves. Jumping to the back of the line. It's probably the oldest canned story that I tell. The chicken and the pig story. The chicken and the pig. First, you got a picture of this, a chicken and a pig walking along. Chicken and pig talking. Okay, once you're past that, here it is. They're walking along in a country road. They come to a diner. And outside of the diner, it says this, breakfast special. 2 eggs and bacon and coffee, $2.99. Now, that's how you know it's an old story, $2.99. Bacon, 2 eggs, and coffee. Today's special. And they look at that, and the chicken just lights up and beams and sticks out of his chest and says, look at that, pig. Look at that. Look what we do. Doesn't that make you feel good? And the pig says, sure. To the chicken, it makes you feel good. All they ask from you is a donation. For me, I have to give my life. 3 times, Jesus will tell his disciples, 3 times, he will tell them about Jerusalem and suffering and being killed. 3 times he will tell them. Each time they can't quite grasp it or maybe not want to grasp it. And even we on this side of the resurrection, do you know what an advantage we have? Even we, seeing how it all works out, even we struggle to always grab a hold of it because the way of the world is just so completely opposite. How is it the world measures life? By power and prestige and popularity and success. But to be the Christ is to live out giving. To be the Christ is to live out caring. To be the Christ is to live out reaching out to others so that all are welcome. To be the followers of the Christ is to do exactly the same. To live by giving, to live by caring, to to live by reaching out to others. Reaching out to some who don't even like us. Reaching out to some who are not at all like us. Reaching out to some whose lives are not indeed likable. But like Jesus, we are called to show love and God's care for all. Doesn't mean we approve, doesn't mean we jump in with them, doesn't mean we always go along with them. It just means we live a life where God calls us to care and to pray and to reach out in possible all kinds of ways. To be all about loving the Lord by loving others in the name of the Lord and by serving and living for others as well. Proclamation to explanation. It's not a catchy phrase. It's not a catchy phrase, but it truly says that what today Jesus makes clear to the disciples is he wants to catch us to be servants in his name, to be empowered today by the meal, to be sent out to love others. Why? Because we've proclaimed it. Jesus is the Christ, a living Lord who loses his life for us on the cross so that we might have life. And now we know what that means for us. Called to serve, called to love, called to reach out with fortitude and by the power of the Holy Spirit. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We stand for the song.
Of Christ be with you all. Let us share the sign of peace in the way that we've been accustomed to do it. Cool. So yeah, you guys can go sit down now and then we'll be good. Every week we talk about offering. We talk about it not in a financial way. We talk about it as a gift from God that we give to God, and also a form of worship. And so we encourage always every week to give this prayer, to give back to God what God has given us, and just as a stewardship and as a way of worshiping. And we want to thank you as we continue the church, as we continue to do work and be the hands and feet of Christ, for all the gifts you give yourself, your gifts of talents, and your gifts of resources. So we say this prayer together. Merciful God, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We will now move into the communion side, and we have tried to do everything possible to keep things sanitary, which we know it will be a little bit different, but we also know that God is present with us in the midst of all of this stuff we cannot understand. Those of you that are joining at home today, I invite you to lift the bread and the wine as I say them in the words of consecration. The Lord be with you. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given up for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup. He blessed it and gave thanks, and gave for all to drink, saying, "This cup is new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." We gather together and we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thy is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. For those joining us at home, for those that are joining us at home, take and eat. Take and eat, take and drink. The body and blood of Christ for you. It is for you today. So please partake in that. For us gathered here today, the way this will work is I will stand here with the bread. Pastor John will stand on this side. I'll have my gloves on, and I will drop the wafer into your hands. Please allow me to drop it, not take it from my hand. And Pastor John will stand here with the wine, and he will bless it and set it there, and you will take it off that table. You can come as a family group, but we ask you to stay as a family group. Nancy Funk and Rick Funk will sort of guide the direction. We're not going to switch sides, so we'll ask you to sort of work your way around the front like this. We're pretty used to the word social distancing, and so we're asking you just to practice that as you come to the communion table. Don't crowd each other. Just wait and take your time. Pastor John and I have said many times, we have plenty of time to do this. Do not rush it. It's the presence of God. It's the presence of God. That is what communion's about. So we will not speed through it. Andrew has offered to sing a song for us while we do that. T-Paul and the praise team will continue to sing songs as long as it takes. But do not rush it, because this is a special, special time. So I invite you, brothers and sisters, this is not my table, your table, or even our table. It's God's table, meaning all are welcome to come and receive the body and blood of Christ. So come, for all is now ready. Give us a second and we'll get started. Joy. We can always use these if we have to. What do you do, John? Now. Huh? Alicia, the body of Christ broken for you. Oh, yeah, you can take your mask off and eat it here, sorry. The body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you. This is the body of Christ broken for you.
Lamb,
Please stand. Hear these words today. The body and blood of our Lord, risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let me start over. The body and blood of our risen Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We sing, Build Your Kingdom Here.
Thanks be to God.